And welcome to the 10th meeting in 2017 of the Finance and Constitution Committee. As usual, can members to put their mobile phones, tablets, etc. into a mode that won't interfere with the proceedings. The first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take item 3 in private and any future consideration in private. Are members agreed?
Yes.
The second item on our agenda is to take evidence on the Budget Process Review Group's interim report from three external members of the group, and I welcome to the meeting Callan Gardner, the Auditor General for Scotland, Professor James Mitchell, Director of Academy of Government at the University of Edinburgh, and Don Peebles, who's the head of Chartered Institute of Public Finance and Accountancy. A very warm welcome our witnesses to the meeting. You've provided us with the rest of the members of the group with a very substantive and detailed interim report. I think it's asked the right questions and certainly has helped initiate a debate which begins today really in the Scottish Parliament and what our new budgetary process could look like. So I'm very grateful for all that input and work that's already been done, and I very warmly welcome you to the meeting. And Caroline, I just wonder, do you want to make an opening statement?
Thank you, Convener. On behalf of the members of the Budget Process Review Group, thanks for inviting us to provide evidence on the group's interim report. As the committee knows very well, the Scotland Acts of 2012 and 2016 devolve substantial new financial and social security powers to the Scottish Parliament. That means that the Scottish budget is becoming increasingly complex and subject to much greater uncertainty and volatility than in the past when the block grant from the UK government was relatively fixed. The Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament will have more choice over tax and spending and more decisions to take about how and when to use the new powers within the agreed fiscal framework. The Scottish Parliament's budget process needs to reflect these fundamental changes in the Scottish public finances. The Budget Process Review Group was established to review the budget process and bring forward proposals for change. We've approached this in two stages. This interim report highlights what we see as some of the key issues, grouped around five key themes, and includes questions for consultation. Following that, we aim to publish a final report with recommendations before the end of June. We've adopted a principles-based approach to our work, aiming for a world-class financial scrutiny process that reflects the Scottish context. Membership of the group includes Scottish Parliament and Scottish Government officials, as well as eight external members, including James Mitchell, Don Peebles, and myself. We've heard from a number of public finance experts who've presented their views, and the interim report reflects the breadth of contributions from members and others. It sets out the issues that need to be considered, but it doesn't at this stage present the agreed findings of the group overall. We're keen to gather a wide range of views from you as parliamentarians, from Civic Scotland and from the Scottish public before agreeing our recommendations later this spring. The consultation we've launched is obviously a very important opportunity for people to have their say. Ultimately, though, we're very clear that it will be for the Scottish Parliament and the Scottish Government to agree a revised process. There are choices to be made on what this will look like and when and how it will be implemented. That will depend to a great extent on what Professor Vayner, backing research we've also published alongside our report, calls the agreed vision for parliamentary scrutiny. It will also require us to decide how best to balance aspirations for what the process might look like with practicality, and I think that will need a careful blend of ambition and realism. Convener, we'll do our best to answer your questions.
Thank you very much. We're going to start immediately with Adam Tompkins. Adam, what do you?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for coming to speak with us this morning and for your work with the review group. One option that has been canvassed in various circles and in various different contexts is that this Parliament should have an annual finance bill, which I understand the House of Commons has. What is the difference between what we currently do and having an annual finance bill, and what, in your views, would be the strengths and limitations of moving to that finance bill model?
Very good question to start with. I think our starting point would be that a move to a finance bill would need to be an integral part of a wider vision, as I touched on in my speaking in my introduction, about the way in which the overall budget process and the scrutiny of it would work. If there is a desire to move towards greater amendment powers for this Parliament, for example, then a finance bill would give you the big picture of both revenue raising and spend in the round, and allow that scrutiny consideration of whether there should be amendments proposed by committees that would then move through to the bill as it was passed in its final form. At the moment, what we're really seeing is proposals for spending within an overall financial envelope, and although there is a provision for amendment at stage one, that's very rarely been used. Instead, we've seen behind-the-scenes negotiations leading to an amendment from the government of the budget bill which is being introduced. So I think there could be real benefits if the Parliament and the government decide that amendment powers would be appropriate within the new process. And from my point of view, I think there would be a benefit in letting you have that big picture of revenue raising and spend and all of the aggregates that come into that, things like the borrowing powers which come through the Scotland Reserve, the ability to smooth expenditure taking one year with another. You'd have that big picture.
So a finance bill would change the balance of power between government and Parliament in Parliament's favour?
A finance bill on its own wouldn't do that. A finance bill together with amendment powers, which is one of the other issues that we're suggesting needs to be considered at this stage of the review of the budget process.
I see. And what would be the cost from a parliamentary point of view? What would be the price of this? Would it have, and in particular, would it have any effect on the amount of time that Parliament has to consider the government's budget proposals?
I think we've taken the view that even if you were to move to this model, there would be many other aspects of the budgetary process, and I think it would be a mistake to focus on only one element in the year. And so therefore, if that is a problem, I think you would need to build into the process other ways of considering scrutiny over the course of the year. I think the great danger would be to see this as say one single event, or even if it's concentrated over a period of time. And so therefore, I mean, we'd be very keen to hear views on this, and you know, we'd kind of reluctant to give our own views at this stage. But I do think we would need to ensure that it is, as Caroline was saying, there's a long term over the whole course of the year process. And that, in other words, if you were to move to a system such as this with any deficiencies, you'd need to build in at other points of the year arrangements to address some of those deficiencies. I think, I mean, that's why we've tried to look at this as a in a more holistic way rather than just to focus on one part.
Yeah, I mean, I understand that. I understand the force of that argument very much. But I'm just trying to understand in a little bit more detail than I currently do exactly what the differences are, both positive and negative from a Parliament point of view, but when you compare what we currently do with what we would be able to do if we had an annual finance bill. So let me give you one example of something that's recently been said as a consequence of us not having a finance bill, and that relates to the air departure tax bill. The air departure tax bill does not contain on the face of the bill all of the detail about the scope of the tax liability. Clearly, it doesn't have anything about bans and rates. You'd expect that. But it doesn't even have everything on the face of the bill about the scope of tax liability, in particular with regard to exemptions. And that's different from the current air departure tax legislation at UK level. And we were told recently by the Cabinet Secretary that that's because there isn't a finance bill. Does that, I mean, how would you reflect on that? Well, not the specifics of ADT, but is it a general or systemic problem for this Parliament, in your view, of not having a finance bill, that we have to pass tax legislation that leaves questions of the scope and of the liability of the tax to secondary instruments?
I suppose we have to be aware that the current process and the design of the budget bill is, as Caroline outlined, for expenditure. And we are in different circumstances now, and those circumstances will change going forward. So questions like that are entirely valid. It's unlikely that through the process we've gone through so far that we have the answer to that. I mean, I think that's a question that we will be seeking answers to, but the interrelationship with other elements of taxation and how the formal expression of all of that can actually be put forward to parliamentarians so that you have as wide and as true a view as possible. If we look at the current situation where there is reliance or an interrelationship between the bill and the need for the Scottish rate resolution, and that stage three can't begin until the rate of resolution has been formalised. That's the type of thing that we have to assess going forward and actually think about what do we actually need to do, and is the expression of all of that right in a single finance bill?
Okay, thank you.
Patrick.
Thank you. Good morning. Just to follow up on that, we have a range of tax instruments now. You mentioned the rate resolution, which has perhaps the highest profile in terms of public debate, partly because it's new and partly because the budget can't proceed to stage three until, as you say, that resolution has been passed. We also have a lower level of scrutiny traditionally for other existing tax instruments. Non-domestic rates, for example, is a negative instrument. It's very rarely been debated in parliamentary committees or in the chamber. Council tax, again, albeit technically is set by local councils, there is a degree of central policy making at the moment around rate capping, previously around a council tax freeze. We've now got quite a wide range, as well as ADT as currently being legislated for. We've got a range of tax instruments and a different level of parliamentary process and scrutiny for each one. Is the finance bill model that you're suggesting intended to square that off and regularise, have a similar standard of parliamentary scrutiny for these different instruments, or would that not be resolved by what you're proposing?
I think I probably should start off by saying we're not necessarily proposing anything at this point. We're seeking people's views. I think the group is very clear that we're moving from a position where, for the first 16 years of its life, Parliament was deciding how to spend, in large part, a block grant that came from Westminster. We're now moving into a very different world where half of what's spent in Scotland will be raised in Scotland. And there are questions that have come through our discussion this morning already about the way the revenue-raising parts of that picture come together. And I think you've highlighted another perspective on that, Mr. Harvey, which is also important. I've reported, as Auditor-General previously, on the fact that we don't anywhere have a single picture of Scotland's public finances that does pull in council tax income, non-domestic rates income, the borrowing powers that came in under the 2012 Scotland Act, and some other aspects. And I think throughout the budget cycle, again, we need to have that picture at the high level with the aggregates that are there as a basis for making decisions about both the priorities for spending and the various revenue-raising measures that come through. A finance bill would be one way of pulling all of that together. There would be timing issues that would need to work through in terms of both the government's ability to prepare the information and Parliament's to scrutinise it, and there's the question about amendment powers. But I think what we're looking to do is to raise the importance of that big picture and how it might work in practice in what will inevitably be both conditions of greater uncertainty and constrained time.
Thank you.
So I've got a quick supplementary myself. It would seem from a perspective of both efficiency and scrutiny that to have a finance bill that contained all of the various elements that we're dealing with through secondary legislation at the moment, on the face of it, would seem to be a reasonable thing to do, because it would improve scrutiny for Parliament, it would improve efficiency in government as well, and not having to bring different things at different times of the year, maybe reduce flexibility a bit for government in terms of change. But how would that, if that was to be the construct that we eventually came to, how would that sit alongside another aspect that was drawn out in the report of this, the idea, I think which is a good idea, around a medium-term examination of the finances of the country that would be seen as part of that holistic picture? How would they sit alongside each other? And can they sit alongside each other comfortably?
Well, I think that is a really good and important question, and I think that's what we're grappling with, is how we fit the pieces together effectively. I think we want to have all of these things. And often, when it comes to budget politics, there are trade-offs. And I think in this case, the way to try to balance that is to ensure that these different processes occur almost separately, but are linked. And it's to get that linkage, how it feeds in. To come back to the kind of example that Patrick Harvey raised, I mean, I think there are so many aspects of the budget process that you would want to look at each year, and you simply can't, you just don't have the time to do it all at once. And so I think in tandem with the bigger picture, you need to have some things running alongside that. But they mustn't just be running alongside that. They've got to feed into the process. And that's where I think one of the challenges lies. It also lies in terms of the different committees and how they operate, the relationship between this committee and other committees, if they are doing work on some of these areas. And I think this is one of the big challenges. It's been challenging enough up until now. It's going to be much more challenging in the future. So that's why I think we've got to get that right. But we don't want to make firm proposals at this stage. I think the danger is if we say X, Y, or Z now, we may come to regret it, and that's why we're keen to get as much feedback from you and others.
Okay. Well, just one other aspect to that, and Adam quite rightly drew my attention to the fact, obviously, we've had a change in the UK budgetary cycle itself. And therefore, what consideration has the group given to that change to autumn in the budget cycle that will fit alongside any medium-term examination of the Scottish finances alongside the economy, no doubt at the same time, and any finance bill. Is there beginning to emerging a picture about how that might sit alongside each other?
Medium-term financial planning in itself will probably be informed by the UK budget, irrespective of the timing. And also, maybe just picking up on what's been discussed, I wouldn't see a choice being made between a medium-term financial plan and a finance bill. I would see the finance bill being the parliamentary expression of all the information that's been brought before parliamentarians, of which a medium-term financial plan would be one component. The way that the UK budget would actually operate would, again, it would inform the financial planning of the Scottish Government. At the moment, the timing, in essence, now has been March. Previously, going back further, the UK budget used to be at two times in the year. They used to announce expenditure in the autumn, and then what we knew generally as the budget in March was actually about the income. And it's relatively recently, probably within the last 20 years, that they've actually brought both of them together to be the consolidated budget that we recognise now. So in actually announcing budget in the autumn, they're actually reverting back in expenditure terms to a position that was quite common previously. There will be an interrelationship with the Scottish Government. The reality is, for parliamentarians, it could actually truncate the timescale that you actually have to examine and scrutinise and budget. And there is the possibility, depending on timing itself, that there may be need for potential revision to Scottish Government budget as a result, depending on when the timing actually is.
Ashton, I have not gone in too much into the territory you wanted to ask. I apologise.
That was what I was going to cover, because the idea that you either have the Scottish draft budget either before you know what's going to be in the UK budget, which means it might be subject to, it could be plenty of scrutiny, but it might be subject to quite substantial revisions, or you have it afterwards when you know what the content's going to be, but obviously that does condense down the period with which you have to scrutinise it. So what do you think, what are your views on that?
I think that dilemma, and it is a real dilemma, is very much behind the group's proposal suggestion that we should be considering scrutiny across the whole budget cycle, not just in that period of 8 weeks or 2 weeks or whatever it ends up being after the UK budget has been announced and before the budget bill or finance bill here has to be approved, but instead focusing the scrutiny over a much longer period, supported by better information, fuller and more usable information than we have in some areas, so that the discussion focuses on the changes really during the period after the UK budget and the introduction of the Scottish budget in whatever form that takes. Now, again, it does mean pulling back and taking that look at the whole system, not just at that bit, but our thinking so far is that that can compensate for it if it is properly supported by good information and support to the Parliament's committees to do their work.
Yeah, I mean, sorry, James.
Yeah, I'm just going to make the point, I think, is one of the big changes that's going to have to be addressed, and it's with respect to this, but other aspects, including reconciliations, there is going to be a lot more uncertainty and there's going to be a lot more change. And so that's hugely influenced the way we've been working to acknowledge that that is there's going to be the new environment. And the dilemma you've raised is a very real one. And I think that means that we have to see, I mean, as Caroline was saying, we have to present this in a more holistic way than perhaps we have. That, I think, it may not be perfect, but it's probably the only way forward. But I think one of the things we've grappled with is uncertainty and change that's going to be introduced to a greater extent than we've had in the past.
Also, I noted with interest you were speaking about this idea of rather than grouping spending it into portfolios, that it was done by linking it to outcomes that the government was trying to achieve. Would you like to say a little bit more about that?
I'll kick off, and then I'm sure Jim will have very strong views as well. I think the group's talked about this a lot and recognises that it has to be a good thing for any government to be thinking about the outcomes it wants to achieve in allocating its budget. That's the main way it's got of changing society life in Scotland. And the National Performance Framework, I think, has been seen as a real trailblazer in setting out clarity about those outcomes and now embedding them in legislation. Where our debate has focused has been much more on how you link the budget to the outcomes. And I think Professor Vayner's report was very helpful to us in demonstrating that actually trying to draw a direct line between what you spend and the outcomes you get is very tricky and can actually dilute accountability rather than strengthening it. That's why our report is talking more about outputs, but outputs that are clearly designed to be sort of staging points towards the outcomes that you want to achieve, linking the spending programmes to the outputs that you want to get, and getting some more clarity there. So, for example, one of the outcomes at the moment in the National Performance Framework is about living our lives safe from crime, disorder and danger. It's quite difficult at the moment to see how all the spending that goes on, primarily in the justice portfolio, but also more widely, is linked to that. But actually, there's been some very good work done in government about how you would go about a programme approach to reducing reoffending. And we think there's room to take the outcomes, work back to the outputs that you're seeking to achieve, and then link your spending much more clearly to them. That seems to us like a very productive way of taking it forward.
Yeah, I mean, I've presented to this committee in the past on outcomes, and I think this is a hugely important point. I mean, if we fail to take into account outcomes, then we will be making a major failing. The only thing I would really want to add to Caroline's comments, I think the work that Audit Scotland has done and continues to do has been hugely important in this respect and should be informing the work of the Parliament as it does. And I think it's a very tricky area to link outcomes to spending. We know there are issues around how long it takes to have an impact and so on. So for those sorts of issues that we've discussed in the past, I think what we're very keen to do and why we have a section on this is to highlight this and to bring it to attention and to ensure that we do not lose sight of outcomes.
Thank you.
Can I maybe just add to that? This might be interesting just for information in the committee to know that, as Caroline rightly says, I mean, you can trace this back to about 10 years of the focus of Parliament and government on outcomes. And Scotland is seen pretty much as a bit of a trailblazer in that regard. Last year, the Northern Ireland executive introduced in the programme for government an outcomes-based approach, which was modelled on Scotland. And 3 years ago, when the Welsh Assembly were actually looking at their budget process, they looked to Scotland about how we actually approach not only budgeting, but our approach to outcomes as well. So we're probably in a good place, notwithstanding that there is work still to do, and a lot of work still to do, as far as our approach generally is concerned with outcomes.
OK, we've got into outcomes a bit quicker than I expected, I did exactly the same, Ash, so don't worry about it. I know Patrick wanted in, but let me get the outcomes a bit finished first, okay. Patrick, and we'll come back to you, because I know that Ivan and Murdo both had questions on outcomes. So.
Thanks, panel, for coming along. Yeah, I just wanted to drill into that a wee bit more, and I see you've looked at, I think, four countries and looked at New Zealand in particular, in terms of what they do. And I think we're very keen to learn more about what's there. And I totally get what you're talking about in terms of you've got the strategy, then you've got the outcomes, if I'm reading this right, which are pretty high level. And then on the other side of this, we've clearly got this focus on inputs, which is, and politicians were terrible at that. We talk about it all the time, and we need to change. We know that, right? And that's clearly all portfolio driven, and it's how you join up. And I'm glad to hear you're talking about what you're calling outputs, which, to my mind, is a kind of lower level in the hierarchy of objectives that the portfolio departments can plug into. So I suppose I just want to probe a bit more in terms of what you learn from looking at other countries, in particular how New Zealand do this. I suppose it's good in one way that Scotland, to some extent, as you say, is at the forefront of this stuff. It's bad in another way that we don't have anyone, perhaps, to learn from. But then also, I don't know if you've looked outside clearly there's differences between the private sector and the public sector, but, and I'm not saying the private sector are good at that, because an awful lot of large private sector companies are very rubbish at this, right? But have you looked at any examples from the private sector in terms of how they would organise strategic objectives, intermediate objectives, lining up departmental spend, and then tracking performance against that?
We've done so far is contained in the report that Professor Vayner prepared for us, which looked across four countries at their overall budget processes. I think in relation to outcomes and outputs, the most relevant were New Zealand and Australia. New Zealand, where they have made this very focused approach to focusing on outputs that are linked to outcomes and that seem to us to have a lot of mileage to explore further in the Scottish context. Australia, where it appears that they're still very much more wedded straight to outcomes, and the concern that that does dilute accountability and make it very hard to see which expenditure is effective and which isn't. We can take away your suggestion that we should be looking at business and other sectors to see if there's something we can learn from. I guess the challenge is that most businesses aren't as transparent about the way they do that sort of planning as governments have been for good reason, but we'll certainly have a look at it.
And in terms of the measures themselves, the national performance framework, etc., do you think there's value in the committee having a look at that, just to see what's there and what measures are in there, and whether they're the most effective ones in terms of what we're trying to achieve here?
I think the national performance framework always ought to be kind of scrutinised, and I think it's an ongoing process. I know that is happening anyway, but I do think it would be it's always useful to do that. I think there's always room for improvement there. I mean, I think in broad principle, it's the right way forward, but we've got to constantly review that. Whether that's part of this process or any other process, I think it's necessary. I would want to emphasise the New Zealand, because I think we were aware of the New Zealand example before we began this work, and I think we had an extremely useful presentation on New Zealand during our deliberations, and it's certainly one. I mean, you're right, and as much as, you know, we may be ahead of the game in many respects, but there are places that we've got much to learn from, and it's very interesting the extent to which New Zealand has emerged very strongly in this respect.
Okay, and then...
Picking up on the National Performance Framework, I mean, I probably want to emphasise, I would see that as an integral part of your deliberations, and it's a part of the process rather than a part of it, and I think that's probably one of the things that going forward we need to consider in relation to outcomes, how that can be consolidated within the process. I think it's right that we're learning from other countries, and it's been very, very revealing, and New Zealand has always been at the forefront. But one of the things that the group picked up from the assessment of other countries is that perhaps paradoxically New Zealand, the Parliament of New Zealand actually takes a minimal approach to scrutiny. Parliament has a minor role in the process, and that they get the budget 1 month before financial year end, and it's 2 months into the financial year before it's actually approved. So for as much as there are many positives, there are other things to learn about the parliamentary approach.
Are you saying that's a something we should then look at to see if that works better, or are you saying that's a negative?
It seems to me that that's a negative.
Right, okay. That's fair. I wasn't clear there. Okay. And I suppose the last thing is round about how we build this into our ongoing work, because I know there's clearly been conversations, if you like, with us asking other committees to do stuff and them going and doing stuff and stuff coming back. But that seems to be the kind of level it's at. There isn't a rigorous process there of saying, these are the questions you should be asking, these are the measures you should be checking, these are your performance measures you should be tracking, these are the kind of outcomes or outputs you should be expecting. To my mind, it looks like we've got an awful lot, we're barely scratching the surface on that. Is that kind of how you see it?
Yes, I mean, I guess it's, we're kind of nervous and reluctant to kind of tell committees how they ought to operate and so on and so forth. I mean, I think the other committees will have their own agendas and they've got their own business and they're all extremely busy. But I do think, how can I put this? You know, if it was at all possible to move towards a more coherent, coordinated approach, that would be good. However, there is a downside to that. And that loses, the other committees would lose some of their autonomy. But I do think, as we move forward into this new environment, I think it becomes ever more important that there is some degree of, perhaps greater degree, I'm trying to word this as carefully as I can, of coordination across committees.
Guidelines on how you might want to approach it might be more.
And again, I think that moving towards this focus on the whole budget cycle rather than budget season helps with that. That committees have got choices about at what point in the year they do it, where they want to focus. If you're a health and sport committee, whereabouts in the year and which particular issues do you want to look into? That can link into the information that government provides, the audit work that's available to them. You can do it much better, I think, if you're looking over a longer period rather than just in a few weeks across the autumn.
I suppose it's getting away from the conversation around about what we're spending the money on and round about what the outcomes are. Okay, thanks very much. Yeah. Thanks.
Murdo.
Thank you, Convener. I mean, I think we've kind of covered a lot of the ground I was going to talk about. I just wanted to go back to this comment, I think it's in paragraph 178 of the draft report, where Auditor General York quoted as saying that enhanced financial reporting could include performance reporting so that it's clearer what spending is aiming to achieve and how this contributes to the government's overall purpose and specific outputs and outcomes. I think what I'm trying to understand is how, in practical terms, how realistic is it to expect government, when it publishes its draft budget, then to specify the level of outcomes or outputs, maybe more accurately, that it would expect to get from that. I mean, Ivan McKee, I thought, made a very fair point. You know, we are obsessed in political debate about inputs, so we'll debate endlessly the number of teachers we have, the number of policemen we have, the number of, police officers, number of nurses and doctors that we have. But, you know, we concentrate much less on the actual outcomes. I mean, how realistic is it? And are there examples elsewhere in the world of governments publishing budgets and at the same time putting specific outputs attached to budget spends?
I guess I'd say yes, there are examples of it, and it's not just about the budget document. We've talked about the National Performance Framework, which is now quite a long-term view of what the priorities are for government, and the architecture is now embedded in legislation. So although future governments may have different priorities, the approach is there until it's positively changed. I think what we're looking for is something which, across the whole budget cycle, is clear about the way government intends to allocate its money, the most important way it's got of making things happen against those priorities. At budget time, there's probably a particular importance in focusing on changes in that, either increasing the amount spent in a particular area or reducing it to invest somewhere else. But there's room for performance reporting alongside the annual financial statements about what's been achieved, and going back to Ivan McKee's question, as committees are scrutinising their particular areas of expertise and interest, to be linking not just what the policy is and what performance looks like, but how much is spent and how that's changed over time. So I think it's about linking the finances and the performance in terms of inputs, outputs and outcomes over a longer period, and doing it right across the budget cycle. That would need a more structured approach to the way all of the committees do their work, I think, and it would also need better, more joined up information from government to make it possible, and from other sources like audit reports.
So just to give you an example, one of the government's stated aims is to eliminate the attainment gap in education. Would it be reasonable, therefore, to expect, in terms of the budget, there was an indication in terms of different budget lines, not just on education, but in terms of, for example, local government allocation, how those funding allocations might impact on that stated objective?
Absolutely. And in response to Ms. Denham's question earlier, I talked about programmes, linking your budget to programmes of activity which are linked to outputs and to outcomes. I think that's a much clearer way of letting Parliament and anybody else with an interest see how the government intends to improve outcomes, to be clear about the way money is moving over time to do that, and then to be able to do the look back and say, how's it going? Is this working, or should we be investing in something else or reducing the amount we spend on that?
Okay. I mean, I would want to stress that, I mean, I think you're touching on something that's hugely difficult, as we all appreciate. And I think what is required from government in terms of transparency is a very clear statement of what they would expect certain spendings to have. So there's a kind of, if you like, to use academic terms, a theory of change alongside the evidence. I mean, if we focus only on numbers and evidence, we can run into real difficulties. So I think you've got to link the two. And that will always be open to challenge, to be questioned, to be scrutinised. And I think that's where the Parliament, its committees, come in. But one would expect government to explain the thinking behind
spending and then to have it challenged. That, I think, is the healthy way forward. That's what good scrutiny should be about. And of course, we're bound to find situations, if I can be quite blunt about it, in which decisions are made, which may not be, frankly, made for reasons of improving outcomes, but may be made because it gets a good headline or whatever else. And come back to the point that a number of members have made about input measures. But that's where I think the role of the Parliament as committees come in, is to question and to challenge some of these. But that's a political process that's open to challenge and such like. But that's the role of Parliament.
Okay.
Patrick, I know, given we've moved into performance areas generally, and Willie had a question in that area, so I'm going to go there first, and I'll come back to your supplementary. Then we'll get on to James and Marie's area.
Thanks,
Bruce. Go, Willie.
Yeah. Do you think, therefore, that the balance of scrutiny is too much weighted at the front end of a process and during a process? And I see some examples in your report where even the Finance Committee or predecessor committee and the Education Committee couldn't see a linkage between spending and outcomes. And in any system where you're trying to assess performance and to hopefully improve anything, you need to close that loop and to make sure that there's some kind of future planning process can be carried out from an examination at the end of a piece of work that's done. These are recurring themes that I well remember during my time at the Audit Committee, and I suppose it's worrying that they're still here, that we're still looking at this, but I think it's really important that we think about where the balance of scrutiny should lie. Sometimes I feel that the committee's let go of a process once the budget is agreed, and we never see the budget or the figures again unless we look at the performance framework. So are you saying to us that the balance of scrutiny, there should be more of a shift in terms of the scrutiny towards the end of a process and the outcomes and performance so that we get it, hopefully get it right next time round?
I suppose if we look at the process at the moment in relation to the budget, all of the activity is actually focused on the point after publication of the budget, up until just before the final public approval of the bill. Thereafter, you can identify elements of scrutiny through subject committees, but there isn't, a golden thread of scrutiny all the way through from the budget proposal through to actual performance, and then the reconsideration of the actual performance and what corrective action should actually be taken, which is why one of the areas that we were interested in looking at, one some international examples, was the extent to which they undertake scrutiny throughout the full year rather than actually just in a truncated period. And that seems to have some merit. And at the moment, we're actually asking the question, what should that all-year-round scrutiny look like? Is it actually preferable? Is it something that would be beneficial? We'd actually have to, of course, consider, as James touched on, the extent to which there is capacity, and that there's going to be trade-offs associated with that, and there may well be some behavioural change necessary amongst the committees to accommodate that, as well as the stakeholders, which now include the Fiscal Commission as well as government.
Is there an issue about consistency as well within different departments that behave and perform in different ways? And when you're looking at your comments in paragraph 186, in terms of the framework, sometimes when you're looking at performance, it's difficult to see, and sometimes departments find it difficult themselves to assess themselves against performance or targets or outcomes or whatever we want to call it. So do we need a kind of more of a consistent theme across the board here to give us all a chance and other committees a chance, an effective chance of doing some real quality scrutiny?
I suppose we have to reflect on a process which has been developed incrementally, the stage three budget process, which is well known, but stage one itself has gone through several iterations. And when that process was designed back in 1999, that was some 8 years in advance of the National Performance Framework, and then behaviour has been modified in some way to actually accommodate that. What we're able to do, I suppose, at this stage is to draw a line and reflect on the last 18 years or so and say, this is where we are, this is what we actually have, and is there a better way that this should all be joined up, and is there a better way that this should link together? And what we've identified is, notwithstanding that we can actually undertake a different form of scrutiny, but we've identified where there are maybe different options for elected politicians to actually consider different forms of information on a medium-term basis, as well as then the budget at the moment. It's probably a quantum leap from budget to national performance framework or vice versa for now.
I think there are a couple of other dimensions to consistency as well, in addition to what Don said. First of all, if you read the budget, I think it's clear that some parts of the Scottish Government are more used to thinking in terms of sort of programmes and outputs and the way spend follows it than others, and I think that's reflected in the committee's comments around it. It can also be quite hard to compare what was actually spent with what was in the budget with readily available figures. You'll very often see budget compared with budget for previous years, even where outturn was quite markedly different from that. We've seen that around student financing in the past. And unless you know what was actually spent, it's hard to make sense of what's being forecast for the future. And a third dimension that we touch on in our interim report is the importance of separating out technical information from political presentation. That it's important that that information is understood, it's clear what's included, and that people can agree on the basis for that, regardless of the political interpretation that every party is going to put on it from their own perspective thereafter. So I think there's room for more consistency in those dimensions too.
Okay. Patrick, we're not too far away from your supplementary now. You want to come in?
It was to pick up on one of the earlier comments on timing, and then just to pick up on something from the interim report. We talked about the timing of an autumn budget at UK level and what impact that has. I'm still not aware of any clarity that's been given by the UK government about what autumn means, and it seems to me there's a big difference between September, before the party conference season, for example, that giving additional time for the Scottish Parliament to conduct scrutiny and discussion of a draft budget and then a budget bill, than if we were talking about November, for example, even late November, which apparently still qualifies as autumn in some people's eyes. Have you been aware of any clarity that's started to form up about what the UK government means when it says autumn?
I have seen nothing. Add to the clarity that you're actually seeking. The most recent example I could think of was the autumn statement, which came in November, as you rightly indicate. The only fixed date that I think in the whole process, fixed to use advisedly, is the date of the written agreement, the 20th September publication date, which would seem to me likely to be in advance of, without any prior knowledge of when the UK government expect to publish its own budget. I would be surprised, although I would stress I don't have any specific information on this, if the UK budget was published in advance of the 20th of September. And if you were to press me to guess, I would think that their publication date would be as late as possible, probably into something like November. But I speculate on that, and I speculate personally rather than as a group member.
I mean, it does seem to me that leaves us in the position of, if we want any substantive parliamentary scrutiny, it has to be on a draft budget that's published before the UK budget.
I don't think we've reached that position as a group yet, and we've done some quite detailed, I mean, scary timelines around the way all of this works and what it means for Revenue Scotland and HMRC in terms of implementing tax rates and so on. So we're considering it carefully. But the other point I would make is that it is now inevitable that there will be greater uncertainty in the budget process than there ever was before. That's just a fact of life. Forecasts are never right. They will change. There will be things that come in from left field, more than ever, I guess, in the current global political context. And the process needs to be resilient enough to cope with that while still having direction and clarity about what government wants to achieve and the chance for Parliament to scrutinise it. And that's really, I think, what we're grappling with, how we make that work.
Yeah, I mean, it certainly affects the wider public sector, not just the devolved administrations. Yeah, absolutely.
Can I just give you a bit of clarity on that myself? Because my understanding is the block grant adjustment won't be published until after the UK autumn budget. And obviously the block grant adjustment mechanism has a significant potential impact on the spending power of any Scottish government, any Scottish Parliament. So how we could come to having solid numbers before knowing what the UK budget position is, and two, what the block grant adjustment mechanism has turned out, would be really a bit like putting a finger in the air and seeing which way the wind was blowing.
Well, I think I,
I wouldn't quite put it that way. I think that's maybe a more extreme way. I mean, it's certainly difficult, but what we would need to try
identify,
not in as much as I think we would need to identify the uncertainties and risk. It's about risk, and therefore measure that risk and work out the extent to which it is likely to change. So that's going to be part of the process. That has to be built into the process. The block grant adjustments will be very, very important. And while we don't know the precise adjustments, what we would always strive to do is to get some sense and build it into the process. That is part of the, and that will have to be part of the whole process of scrutiny as well. Are assumptions fair and valid? Have we, you know, assessed the risk adequately? So I think, but again, it comes back to the point that we've been stressing, is the new system is now replete with uncertainty to an extent that we've never had before.
Timing issues.
Well, yeah, it's relating to your discussion of alternative tax and spending proposals from paragraph 54 onwards.
Because otherwise I'm doing a disservice to other members.
Okay, I'll be happy to come back
I'll come back to that because James and you wanted to discuss the issues around multi-year budgeting, etc.
So. Yeah, some of this has already been covered, but I mean, I suppose in a sense, looking at the discussion so far, what we're trying to achieve is a better budget process through more quality information, which ensures that we make better decisions in terms of how the money is allocated to individual budget lines. And we've spoken about multi-year budgets and separate to that, you know, financial planning. And one of the issues around both multi-year budgets and financial planning in terms of the Parliament getting more involved is the, you know, the resource that's involved in that around committees and the challenge in terms of committees. So in terms of being able to kind of strip it down to kind of various areas, what are the kind of fixed and the variable areas of the budget that, you know, that can be separated for the parliamentary committees to look at in terms both of financial planning and multi-year budgets?
I'm still formulating my answer.
As you were talking, Mr. Kelly, I'm not sure there will be many things that are fixed in future. Yeah. In a sense, there haven't been in the past, that it's always the block grant has always depended on decisions made by the UK government, and we've seen both changes year on year and in year consequentials coming through from decisions taken in Westminster. What we're doing now is taking that and multiplying it several times with different revenue streams in Scotland, block grant adjustments for the different taxes, and new borrowing and reserve powers to smooth things year on year. So all of that is moving. I guess one of the things that we're toying with turning over in the group is the importance of this committee particularly having the chance to scrutinise the government's long-term financial planning, its thinking about financial priorities, about the fiscal context they're working in, the fiscal and economic forecasts that come through, and the high-level choices within that about investment in particular areas and disinvestment in others. And subject committees taking their area of interest, the programmes and organisations and budgets associated with it, and looking at those alongside the priorities, but also the performance and the activity that's going on. So I think that there's uncertainty in all of it, but the process that I think is forming in the group's thinking is about a much deeper and broader understanding of how that works at the broad level here for this committee and the sort of depth coming through the subject committees. Jim.
Yeah, you threw me because I thought your question was heading in one direction and then it kind of came to the question you asked. Can I maybe address the question I thought was coming, certainly was implicit in the early part, and that was about capacity. Because I thought you were going to be asking a question there about do we have the capacity in the Parliament to deal with some of these things. And I think that is a hugely important issue that we haven't really touched on in the discussion so far. And I think that is something that we are grappling with. If we are moving to this more complex, more uncertain system with more data, more uncertainty around that data,
I think there is a big question as to whether we have the capacity in the Parliament to deal with this, and if not, then what do we do? And that's this has been an issue that we have discussed, and I guess it really informs much of the broader discussion. I think we've looked at this in terms of both the part, well, we're interested in views on the Parliament itself, but also other bodies about ensuring that other extra parliamentary institutions, including audit, including academic institutions, how they can be brought in into the process. So that's where my head was heading when you were asking a question. And if you don't mind, I'll kind of, it wasn't actually the question you asked, but I thought it was implicit in the first part. And I do think it's a hugely important matter that we are really interested in thoughts on that.
Offer you an answer on that one, I thought about sure. What you were actually talking about in the fixed and the variable. It was making me think of, I suppose, the closest that we get to multi-year budgets at the moment is through the spending review, which has been with us for around 30 years or so. And the intention behind the spending review was that it would add some form of certainty to departmental expenditure limits for a period of about 3 years, although reviewed every two, with the exception of AMI, which was going to be on an annual basis. So I guess in the terms that we've actually used, if we think about AMI as being the variable, and to a large extent we can fix the departmental limits for around about 3 years. That tends to be, however, for the resource budgets and for a short period of time, and it tends to be spending review based in Westminster, followed by a spending review at a point in time, but then the Scottish Government. What's missing from that is the longer-term look and to see how that short-term consideration fits into what is the longer-term view and the longer-term approach that needs to be taken by government. So I think what you'll actually find that with, if it's accepted, an introduction of, say, a medium to longer-term approach to financial planning, that the gaps that you've actually rightly highlighted will actually start to fall into place and you'll have a wider picture to undertake objective scrutiny on government finances.
Okay, thanks for that. Just to round off with a comment, Convener, just thank Professor Mitchell for the answer he gave, as opposed to the question I answered. That. I mean, I think he does highlight some really important issues. You know, we've spoke at length in this committee in recent months, particularly when we've been looking at the recent budget, about the importance of the decisions that have been taken, about all the changes, of the scale of it. And as I said in my original sort of a summary, it's about, you know, being able to provide more information so that parliamentarians can take appropriate decisions that make a difference. Because this isn't just about, you know, getting all the numbers in and making sure that they add up. Ultimately, there are hundreds of budget lines which impact on people's lives out there. And if we want to make sure that we get it right, we need a process that supports that. And it's not just a case of people, you know, coming to the committees, you know, looking at the papers, agreeing with the recommendations. We want people to be informed, and you're right, that needs expertise and it needs resource to do that.
Can I just answer that very briefly? In the interest of fairness, I think that is equally true for Scottish Government. I think we see that Scottish Government is facing similar capacity challenges in being able to manage all of this. And it's why I referred in my opening remarks to needing to get right that balance between the aspiration of where we get to and the sort of practicality of the steps along the way. We're not going to have all of this in place for 17, 18 or 18, 19. But where do we want to get to and what's reasonable to do to get there?
Marie, you're in the same area.
Thank you. I wanted to ask about the different options in terms of medium-term planning. So you can every year look maybe 3 or 5 years ahead, or alternatively you can each parliamentary term, so the term of the government, can plan for that term. Now, I can see that there are advantages and disadvantages of both systems, and I just wondered if you wanted to give some comment on that for me.
We come to a view on it yet. We are clear there's a need for a more transparent set of a medium-term financial plan that contains a whole range of things like the assumptions that underlie it, different scenarios, the priorities in broad terms that are required, and that will need to be refreshed by government anyway to keep it useful and to make it a reasonable underpinning for the annual cycle that needs to happen. Now, the extent to which it's a good use of parliamentary time to be digging into that every year, as opposed to doing it once in a parliament or two or three times in a parliament, I think we really haven't explored yet. But there absolutely is, again, another trade-off there that takes us back to those questions about capacity in parliament and in government, I think. And we'd be very keen to hear your views, as James keeps saying.
Okay, and the other thing I wondered, I mean, this year in the Health and Sport Committee, which I'm also a member of, we drilled down particularly into the health and social integration budgeting rather than looking at the whole budget. And one of the things that we heard loud and clear was that they would like to have the ability to plan further ahead, medium term, and to have perhaps multi-year budgets. Are there other areas that are very keen for that, or are there other areas where it would be particularly relevant that you're hearing about?
I haven't detected any resistance generally throughout the public sector ever about a move towards medium-term financial planning. I think that some of the barriers that are seen usually focuses on funding, which sometimes comes back to multi-year budgeting or the ability to budget multi-year at government level, in effect. But my sense is this, that if we actually focus on funding and see that as a barrier, if we think about the expenditure side, that services, organisations, departments are actually taking decisions which will in fact have a long-term effect, whether it be a care package, whether it be investing in infrastructure. There are decisions that are actually being taken on the expenditure side which necessarily are long-term, and it seems to be natural that if you can actually take those decisions as an elected politician, whether nationally or locally, then that would actually translate naturally into the desire to actually have information which would give you additional suite of information to assist those longer-term pieces of information. You're right to focus on integration of health and social care, and it's a new area, or a new governance area, in effect, with the reformulation of the IJBs. The issue that they have is the interrelationship between themselves, the health board and local government. Both sectors actually have their own issues associated with their ability to do multi-year budget. And I think what you're actually touching on there is, I suppose, a combined pressure, in effect, which in itself won't necessarily be resolved by the introduction of multi-year budgets or medium-term financial planning, but in themselves, they do have the ability to actually do so, from government all the way to individual health and local government bodies.
Thank you.
Well, you were asking for comments, and I've been thinking through this area as we've been talking, and there's an issue here that even although we had the capacity in Parliament and we had the capacity in government, is it the right thing to do? And why I ask that question is, do we want to crowd out, would we be careful not to crowd out too much that we leave the politics to the side, because actually Parliament is a political place and there's a space for politics and all of this as well. And I think that the Financial Issues Advisory Group, in designing what they designed in the setup of the Parliament, left enough room for Parliament to be able to breathe, but for still whatever shape of government, whether it was coalition, majority or minority government, they would still be able to have some stability through a process. So I think they did a good job there. But when I read in bits of the report, for instance, in paragraph 26, where people like the IMF and OECD are talking about potentially having recommending seven different budget reports at different points in the budget and the budget cycle, that does begin to make me worry a bit about, we do crowd out the politicians, we don't leave enough room for space for the political discourse to take place, and in designing a world-class process, which is technically very, very efficient, we've not got that room that we all require as politicians to have the discussions that we all know go on between parties, between individuals. And it's a worry that's just beginning to develop in my head as we go through this process. So I want to ask you, as part of your process, are you bearing that political space in mind as we try to design this world-class process?
Well, what is planning? requirement is that trying to identify the correct suite of information to enable parliamentarians to undertake that political debate in as enriched a way as possible. And you're right to focus on the OECD suite of reports, that which has been expressed in number 7. But rather than volume, if you actually think of the information that's in there, that's actually their formulation of what they think for any government is necessary to actually undertake that that discussion. The ability or capacity, rather, to actually consume 7 reports, you're right to focus on that. And we don't actually have the answer to that at the moment, but what we're actually trying to focus on is the extent to which additional information beyond what you actually have at the moment and in relation to the new powers that are actually coming along is necessary to enable you to have that discussion. And I think that's the right focus. What is it that you actually need to enable you to undertake those political discussions rather than be overwhelmed by potential volume of reports that could come your way?
I think it's a really important question, Convener, and it is at the heart of what we're trying to reconcile here. First of all, I think Professor Vayner pointed out to us that although FIAG said it wanted to design a process that entailed much more parliamentary scrutiny than at Westminster, in practice that hasn't actually come through either in terms of the amount of scrutiny within the process as it stands or in the lack of any amendment powers that the Parliament has got. And we're thinking about what that means and whether those principles are still fit for purpose in a parliament that is raising half of what it spends for the first time. A second observation, personally, really, I think, is we've talked a lot this morning about New Zealand, and we'd been looking at it in Audit Scotland because of the way they do lots of that in-year scrutiny of what's happening with the budget. And the thing I'm most struck by about that process is how apolitical it is. Things that would be front page of the Scotsman every month here just seem to pass without very much comment at all in New Zealand. And clearly there's a cultural dimension to that, there's an institutional dimension. But I think very much where our thinking is going now is what's the right balance for Scotland to get those principles, to get transparency, scrutiny, accountability in, but to make it something that works as well.
I mean, the only thing I would add is that I think there is a big question, and it bears on the role of Parliament more broadly than just the budgetary process, and that is the relationship between the executive and the Parliament. And you know, the literature on comparative legislatures would suggest that there's a continuum. One end, you've got what are often referred to as transformative institutions that are able to truly transform recommendations coming from the executive, or indeed initiate, right through to what are often referred to as arenas, where essentially they rubber stamp. And I mean, the classic example of a transformative institution is Congress in the United States. However one looks at the budgetary processes there, we certainly don't want to go down that route, whereby you basically have pork barrel politics with members just adding lines and adding lines. And it's a deeply fiscally irresponsible form of budgetary politics. I think, as Professor Werner has pointed out in his work, the Westminster model, which essentially this Parliament has copied, lies towards the other end of the spectrum. In fact, in many respects, it's a liberal democracy. We are a bit of an outlier. And I think there is a big question to be raised, which we can't really address. This is for Parliament, as to whether you want to move the Parliament further along towards a more, without moving to the congressional end of the spectrum, a more transformative type of institution, and where on that spectrum you would wish to go. We don't tend to see, as has often been observed, the kind of amendments to finance bills here or at Westminster that you would get in, say, Germany, as Professor Werner has pointed out. What we would like to think is that the processes that we are considering and that we will recommend will at the very least permit that kind of move. But ultimately, it will be up to others to make decisions as to whether they take advantage of that. I mean, I hear your point about the danger of in a sense, overwhelming members with too much information. My tendency is to think you can almost never get too much information as long as it's quality information. But I do think there is a filtering process, and this comes back to the point I was trying to make earlier about capacity. And I think these are all interlinked. But in terms of that spectrum, and I would say it's a spectrum rather than as a binary divide of
you know, more transformative. The initial intention, if you go back to the CSG, the IEG, was that this Parliament would be a more transformative institution. I don't think that's happened.
We're on amendments, Neil, so you were interested in that area in particular. So.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's very interesting what we've just been discussing there. I note from your report and Professor Vayner's contribution about lodging amendments that you haven't reached the defined view on the issue of lodging amendments during the budget process. And I know you'll want to explore this further with the committee and with others about what if any mechanism should be used in that regard. But I think surely, in general, I'm kind of keen to kind of find out more about your hesitation to actually come to a view on that, and also to see surely in general that we should have a mechanism, or the Parliament and Parliament Committee should have a right to lodge amendments during the budget process. I suppose that's feedback and a question.
I guess our starting point is that we're very conscious that we will make recommendations and Parliament and Government will have to agree them. So one of the reasons for going through this interim phase is to get feedback, to get soundings on where our political system is in thinking about how far the five principles are fit for purpose and have worked in practice, and how far we need to change that, and how far things are changed, whatever we think, by the introduction of significant revenue-raising powers. James talked about the risk of amendment powers leading to pork barrel politics. We've seen that in other countries as well as the US, and Professor Vayner makes the point again that you need to think in terms of institutional checks and balances. It's possible to have amendment powers where you're working within a fixed ceiling of revenue to be spent. So you're not, if you're looking to increase something, you have to reduce something else. Equally, it's possible to make your amendment powers wide open so that if more is being spent, the money needs to be found somewhere. There's a spectrum of choices to be made, but the vision, I think, for what the political system looks like in relation to the budget needs to be a decision between Parliament and Government, and needs to be one that works in the Scottish context, and we're really testing out views and perspectives on that right now.
Can I add one other dimension to this, and that is one that members will be aware of, is that while there may not be formal amendments moved in the Parliament, there are negotiations that will take place, particularly under minority government, but not just under minority government. And I think there's a really interesting question here around transparency. And on the other hand, I think you know one of the great problems in any negotiation is that negotiations taking place in public are very difficult to be conducted. I mean, you do need some degree of privacy, but I do think therein lies a real challenge, given that transparency is another of the key objectives in any good parliamentary process. So in a sense, it's not that amendments aren't entirely being put forward, though notwithstanding your point, I think your point is very well made, but in a sense there are opportunities for parties to have an input, and we're really struggling with this, to be honest. How do we take that into account? It does happen, as I see someone nodding their head vigorously, as suggests may have been part of that process. But I do think there is a real issue here.
On
you go, Neil.
Yeah, just on the issue of amendments and transparency. Obviously, the past budget, and you've obviously got to, what you're saying is, show where money's coming from, etc. If you're going to put forward amendments, the last budget, we saw a substantial amount of money come from underspend, brought forward from what's normally declared in June. And I raised with the Finance Secretary previously that there should be a great more transparency about underspend, because that is a potentially significant sum of money that could be used for potential amendments. Now, the Cabinet Secretary, to be fair to him, has said that he's willing, if we ask for it, to provide more information on an ongoing basis about where underspends are in various stages of the budget process. So I just wanted to kind of just get your thoughts on whether that should be formalised more in terms of actually the committee and Parliament knowing what are the underspends, I don't know on what basis, but certainly during the budget process, to allow us to make more informed decisions and that obviously relates and transparency, and that allows that kind of relates to the budget process. Yeah.
I think that actually goes to the heart of what we're actually discussing here about the what the new process should actually look like and what is the information complement that is actually required. And that you've probably hit on a good example of that. The public has a time for that to be provided to committees and to parliamentarians. And I wouldn't want to focus necessarily and only on underspends, important that actually is. But I think it's maybe important to say that as one part of an additional suite of information that should be placed in front of you to actually make an informed discussion or have an informed choice potentially about what amendment, if any, is necessary or what alternative spending proposals could be made, which is based on best information possible. And that probably comes back also to the reluctance to be overwhelmed by an additional suite of information. That's going to add to the information because there will have to be this trade-off between your capacity to consume that information and then to channel that into discussions with government, with other parties about what potential amendments could be made.
Well, Patrick, you and I have been involved in lots of these transparent discussions in the past.
Sometimes well and sometimes badly, and that's part of the problem here. I was fascinated by this comparison between the earlier section on alternative proposals from paragraph 54 and the later discussion on informal negotiations from paragraph 106. It seems to me that first section is arguing for early opportunities, or suggesting that the FIAG argued for early opportunities for Parliament to consider alternative proposals, to subject them to scrutiny. Now, that clearly requires more transparency than we've seen to date on things like how much flexibility the government really has available to it, and on year-to-year comparisons so that people can see what the changes actually amount to, as well as being able to assess things like the socioeconomic impact of budget changes now that tax is part of the mix as well as spending. But inevitably, as you say, there are also these processes of informal negotiations. Now, they happen differently under different forms of government. In a coalition, and I remember during the last period of coalition in the Scottish Parliament, there were already concerns that the informal discussions that happen in the formation of a coalition government are also in private, but they can risk leading to a lack of coherence about the financial impact throughout an entire term of Parliament, because those negotiations happened at the beginning and they don't necessarily give the flexibility. They'll kind of lock in priorities based on the political value that each party in the coalition attaches to them. And so you end up with a less coherence about the budget overall. They happen differently with a majority administration, which can choose to listen if it wishes but doesn't have to, and differently again with informal negotiations, which occasionally, not always, but occasionally have been at the level of games of brinkmanship at literally the last minutes and hours of the process. Now, it seems to me that if we want a process that works for all of these different scenarios, alternative proposals, wherever they come from, whether from one individual member of a government backbencher or of an opposition party, or from opposition groups, or from outside Parliament, all need to be subject to parliamentary scrutiny. And that if there's that requirement that anyone proposing a particular budget change comes and give evidence to this committee or its successor prior to that last-minute process, it creates an absolute requirement on those involved in informal discussions to do them early, to result in proposals that can then be subject to scrutiny, and that members or others who are seeking to persuade colleagues of change have to persuade Parliament rather than just be seen to be in a one-to-one arrangement with government, the implication being that this is all about the power of government to grant its goodness on whoever it chooses.
That was very useful.
Yeah. And I think you summarised some of the challenges we face and some of the questions. What I mean, I mean, what we would want to have, I mean, I think you said a system that would work under any of these scenarios, and I think that is exactly what we want. And I think that that may mean that we end up having a number of ways, a multitude of ways, assessing at the outset of a parliament and right the way through. The danger is that if we were to draw up a list of all the different ways we could scrutinise, you're going to spend all your time in this parliament scrutinising the budget, and that may be a problem.
But so what I'm suggesting is that it boils down to one principle, that whoever is looking to influence change, at some point in the process has to come and do it publicly in front of parliamentary committees and answer questions.
Yes. I mean, I take the point. I mean, I think, and I do think I was just looking for it in the report, I do think we make that point about the, at the outset of a parliament, the importance of scrutinising the policies and, of course, the budgetary implications of these are important. So, yes, absolutely. And we're very conscious of that in our deliberations. I'm not pretending it's easy, and I'm not pretending that particularly, I think there has always been and always will be, and it doesn't just apply to budgetary politics. I hesitate to give some other examples, but there are always occasions when negotiations will have to take place in private. But after the negotiations, there needs to be public scrutiny. If you like, it's the old Woodrow Wilson, first, you know, it's a great political scientist, student of government, as well as an American president. He used to talk about open covenants, openly arrived at. That is a totally discredited notion. You cannot arrive at a decision through negotiation in public. What you do need, however, is that once a decision has been made, that needs to be open to scrutiny. And I guess that's where, I'm speaking very personal here, but I'm not speaking about colleagues, I think that may be where we need to ensure we get to. I don't know if that helps.
Thank you.
And I think focusing on the report itself, the two sections of the report that you highlight, Mr. Harvey, really reflect the fact we haven't yet reached a position on whether we should be recommending amendment powers. If not, then there will continue to be informal negotiations. And there's a question, as James has been saying, about how you get some transparency around that process.
OK, I've really got two observations rather than questions, but happy to get any comments. And it just follows on from Mr. Bibby's lines of questioning. First is in relation to the size of the budget. When the draft budget was presented in December, we went through a process between that point and February, when we had the stage one debate, where £185 million extra appeared. Some of that was from underspend, some of that was from the business rates pool, 185 million. The finance secretary then found another 42 million 3 weeks later in relation to addressing an issue with business rates. And then we had Barnett consequentials from the UK government's spring budget of, I think, 145 million. So the final budget for the coming year is, according to my rough calculations, more than £370 million higher than the draft budget that was presented to Parliament in December, which this committee and other committees of Parliament sought to scrutinise. And I think there is an issue there in terms of how do we properly scrutinise a budget when, in fact, there's a lot more money that subsequently appears. My second point is the point about amendments. And I remember I raised this privately when this committee looked at our budget report, because when we considered our budget report, it's very clear in the rules that any members proposing an amendment to the budget report that would increase spending have to specify where spending would reduce and vice versa. And it seems to me this is actually rather out of date as a rule, because it would apply when we had a fixed budget, but our budget is no longer fixed. Our budget is to a large extent dependent upon the growth or decline of the Scottish economy. So, for example, the Scottish Government will argue that by seeking to reduce air departure tax, to pick a very current example, they don't need to replace every penny that would be lost because there'll be growth in the tax revenue elsewhere. And therefore, if I was going to propose a tax cut, for example, in terms of the budget, I would be arguing that we could replace at least some of that money by economic growth and get that back. So I'm just wondering if that rule that we're currently bound by actually is out of date and needs to be revised.
Can I comment on your first observation, Mr. Fraser. I absolutely recognise what you're describing about this budget round, and it has applied to others. For me, it comes back to this importance of the big picture, the block grant from Westminster and the forecasts of the revenues from the devolved and assigned taxes is not any longer the big picture. We have got increasing powers for revenue borrowing, the Scotland Reserve, other pockets of revenue like non-domestic rates, which are all accounted for outside the core of the budget document. And I think having that big picture, whatever the legislative vehicle looks like in future, is very important to understand the choices that you're making and the fiscal risks that may be involved as well, the longer sustainability questions that come through. I've reported separately that we don't have that in outturn terms. We've got the Scottish Consolidated Fund, but there's a lot of activity around that that's not captured there. And the same is equally true in budgetary terms. And I think it's increasingly important to have that picture to understand what the scale of room for manoeuvre is and to be thinking about the long-term fiscal sustainability of choices that are being made as well.
And the second point, just a comment.
Yeah, I mean, I'm happy if anyone's got a view, but it's just a comment.
The only comment, and it's a challenging one to comment upon. I mean, I guess the only comment I think at this stage we could give, or I could give, again, I don't want to align myself with others who may not want to be aligned with this view, but I think the only point I would make is then it's the role of Parliament to challenge assumptions that government may be making about changes in terms of taxation and to look at the evidence. If there are assumptions that by increasing or decreasing a particular tax, therefore you will have a growth in the economy and therefore you will have a bigger tax take. If that is, if that could be backed up with evidence, then that would be fine. And I think if you feel as a member that can't be, then I guess it's your role to challenge it. That's where the politics comes into it. And I don't think there's any kind of process that can address that. That's if you like, this is a highly political process.
Yes, I think the point, Mr. Mitchell, was that the rules we currently operate under do not allow us to have that debate.
Sure.
Yeah.
Well, okay, moving on, because to an important area, which we've not actually covered yet, and because this has all been about government and parliament, but obviously, how do we involve the public? And I think Liam had issues around that.
Yes, thank you, Convener. Good morning. So that's exactly the issue. The discussion has been very technical. Professor Mitchell, you talked about the move to a more complex, more uncertain system. James Kelly was talking about hundreds of budget lines. The interim report talks about public engagement. So the question is basically, first of all, what does the group see Civic Scotland adding to this process, which arguably has little interest to Civic Scotland and perhaps even less understanding?
I would probably maybe challenge the implicit assumption that it's of little interest to Civic Scotland. I would have thought it had been at the heart of what Civic Scotland should be interested in. Where I would agree is that I think the overall premise of public engagement, I think, has been difficult over a long period of time. And I think that if you look at the practical elements of the budget, it's in numbers and it's in a scale that few people can actually comprehend, can actually understand. And the budget documentation is not presented in a way which would be, to, if I can use the phrase ordinary citizen, be meaningful to him or her. I think if you look at the developments that have taken place over the last few years, as far as the Community Empowerment Act is concerned, and the ability now of individuals to become involved in budgeting at a participative level, a local level, which I suppose is more meaningful to them, I think that's where you can actually find public engagement of probably the pure type that we probably understand. If you think of the scrutiny process that this committee goes through, you probably don't see many members of the public. You will see representatives from Civic Scotland, you'll see groups, you'll see organisations that that we represent as well. The question that we're actually asking openly is what are we actually seeking to achieve from public engagement. I know that in the past, this committee has actually gone to the public. You've gone to separate towns to actually speak to organisations or individuals. You've used social media. It's a question that we're genuinely asking, that what should public engagement look like? How do we get the public to engage with us? It's not uncommon in matters of public finance, being talking to someone who actually puts information into the public domain, and to find it difficult to get individuals to engage with what can be complex documents. And sometimes the barrier is that they're not presented in a way which is understandable, easily readable to individuals. And because public bodies have a complex story to tell, it's sometimes difficult to actually translate that into something that is easily readable. So it is an open question about public engagement and what that should actually look like. But instinctively, I think that there should be a direct line to the public, and the public should have a direct line to this process.
Can I add to that? I think in many ways it absolutely is difficult, you're right, and it's never been more important. Going back to the premise of Murdo Fraser's question, we're moving into a new world where Scotland has, to some extent, a choice between the sort of society it wants to be. Does it want to be relatively high tax, high public services like Scandinavian countries? Does it want to be low tax, lower public services like the US? And that's a discussion that only the public can have. At the moment, it happens indirectly through people's support for political parties. The budget process, I think, is a chance to open up that conversation. And there are some really interesting things underway. My predecessor took part in a citizens' jury back in about 2010, where people got very engaged in understanding public finances and the choices that were there. I think James's colleagues at the Academy of Government have done some very interesting work on citizens' budgets and budgeting, where people are being very much involved in the choices and trade-offs that happen. I think in the report, we're not saying it's an easy thing to do, but increasingly it's a very important thing to do, and we don't want to lose sight of that dimension to the changes that the Parliament is currently considering.
I mean, absolutely, some of my colleagues very much on participatory budgeting, for example, but I guess that wouldn't be so relevant. But particularly in terms of the citizen engagement, I think we've got to distinguish between Civic Scotland's engagement, by which I would refer to institutions and organised interests, and the public. I think it's much more challenging with the public than it is with Civic Scotland. With Civic Scotland, I think the challenge here is one that I know this Parliament is well aware of, and that is, how do you avoid going to the usual suspects? How do you broaden it out? And I think one of the lessons that we've learned from the work of this Parliament is to get out there, is not to expect people to come here. It's conscious of the language that's used, and also the kind of level of discussion. I don't think there's much point in getting members of the public together and starting to talk about some of the technical detail, but these issues all affect the public. In that respect, they are of interest, they affect people's lives, and I think it's a challenge for Parliament to find a way of articulating itself and listening to the public. I have to say, I think you're better at it than we are in that respect. It's part of your daily job. It's what you do. You engage with constituents and the public, and I think we need to try to harness that and not just have it as kind of saying, you know, it's elections coming around. Well, maybe they come around quite often, but in terms of kind of engaging with some of these issues. But again, it comes back to the kind of some of the discussion we've been having in this document about the different approaches, the different kind of opportunities for scrutiny, and there may be some that are more appropriate for public engagement, for Civic Scotland engagement. But I do stress that Civic Scotland one, the thing I think the biggest challenge here is one I know the Parliament's been grappling with, and that is to avoid the usual suspects.
That certainly addresses the how. Mr. Peebles, you posed the question in your answer about the why. I think you said, what do we seek to achieve with the public engagement? And I appreciate Carolyn Gardner gave some answer to that. But if I might pose the question again, because I'm not sure it was asked, the how, I concede, is complex. But the why, I think, given the points that you make, Professor Mitchell, about what we are here to do as representatives, and the expertise on the group that's putting the process together, why are we then What are we seeking to achieve by going to the public?
The public are the experts. They experience the public services. And I think you can learn a great deal from engaging with the public. I think in public policy, the failure to do so has been one of the historic errors, and I'm talking about over a long period of time, we've had in Scotland. We've done things to people, for people, rather than with people. I speak now as a former member of the Christie Commission, that I think one of the key things we've got to continue to strive to do is to engage. And I think the Parliament does a reasonably good job, does a much better job than many other institutions. But that's why, because you can have technical expertise, but there is no greater expert in terms of public policy provision than those people who are experiencing on the ground. We can learn an enormous amount from people. We can, you know, it's remarkable the amount of change that you can bring about, and it may seem small scale. And it's about the prioritisation, it's about the big, big questions Caroline's talking about, but it's often about quite minute detail. You know, I don't have the experience of some of the welfare reforms, for example, that many members of the public, in that respect, they have an expertise I couldn't have. So I think there's different levels of ways of looking at this. I don't know if that answers your question.
Well, no, I think it does. And I think it emphasises the point that you actually made earlier on, that it's about making sure that the usual suspects are not the ones with the loudest voices.
Okay. So that's been a very, very helpful session. I think from our perspective, I hope too, from your perspective, I guess the nub of the issue you're having to tackle is, how do we get a system where there's an appropriate level of scrutiny and challenge for Parliament, at the same time allow a government to make sure that it gets through a safe budget to support the economic well-being and the public services? And at the end of that, when you're finishing that process and coming to a conclusion in Parliament, actually getting an all-party agreement around this to make sure that the public themselves see that there's confidence in the Parliament and the system, that's the only way they're going to have confidence in it. So it's quite a challenge that you've been set and we've been set. So, but thank you very much for coming along and helping us initiate that challenge today and begin to unpick about a lot of the work you've been going through. And I look forward to the final report when it comes out. Thank you very much. And we suspend just for 5 minutes. Thank you.